So the case study I presented, this was the first slide, now it comes up again, almost towards the end, and it got cut off there. Sometimes if I reboot the app, it'll fix itself. Let me try that real quick, sorry. In the case study, the disease is something called myasthenia gravis. The tired swimmer. And I guess you knew it'd have something to do with muscle tissue. So now we should be able to understand how a case study pertains to something we're learning about. It means weak muscle, okay, my is muscle, gravis, weak, which occurs in about one in every 20,000 persons, so it's very rare, which is why I think I shared with y'all, I was surprised, I had a student who had this. The case study reflects my personal experience with this student. Causes muscle paralysis, fatigue, so it could be life-threatening if the muscle paralysis is, for example, your diaphragm. Okay, now if it doesn't threaten the diaphragm function, then it shouldn't be life-threatening, but still needs to be treated. So what's happening is antibodies attack acetylcholine receptors, which you now know what those are, in these patients. And so therefore, this is an autoimmune disease, right? Because your antibodies shouldn't attack your own molecules, right? What happens is you get a virus, and what your immune system normally does, and you'll learn this when you take immunology in 431, is you create an antibody, you create a clone, a B cell clone that's specific for that bug, right? But if the molecule shape for the antibody that you make against it happens to be close to something else in your body, well, the antibodies don't distinguish then. It just made a molecule that's supposed to attack the virus, but a bad side effect is it also attacks you. Now, usually that shouldn't happen. But this does, about one in every 20,000 persons. And it happens to make an antibody against this, which is also attacking another foreign particle, usually secreted by the thyroid. We'll get into that. But what you need to understand is antibodies are attacking your ACHR. ABs attack ACHR. So therefore, you're going to have reduced functional ACHR. So how is that going to affect muscle? Well, it's kind of, we don't here. Those are in the postsynaptic membrane, right? You know all that. You studied the neuromuscular junction since we last met, I think. If disease causes paralysis, the respiratory muscles, death can occur. I mentioned that. Other symptoms include generalized fatigue, blur, double vision, because muscles in the eye, not just muscles that move your eye, but muscles that control the focus of the lens, called lens accommodation, can be affected. Treatment may include thymus removal. That's a gland close to your heart. Administration of some drugs, neostigmine or anticholinesterase, they can help. And now that you understand what the postsynaptic membrane is and ACHR, you can kind of see how these drugs might be effective for a person. So let me explain to you how the drug treatment works. Drug RX, right, that's treatment. So these drugs, what they do is they react with acetylcholine esterase and thus allow acetylcholine to stay in the synaptic cleft longer. If you remember from our studies, I call it the ACHE, right? So you're like binding that, making it less effective. Now what's it supposed to do? ACHE normally gets rid of the ACH to stop the muscle contraction, normally. But in this pathology where you have reduced ACHR and you wanna like retain the function of the few you have, this helps. So by this drug, whatever it is, those two there, binds up ACHE. Okay, so you're decreasing this, the activity of this. By doing that, ACH persists in the synaptic cleft longer as a result. I'll say ACH persists in the synapse longer. And we think the reason why it can help is, well, if it's there longer, the fewer functional ACHRs you got have more time to react. Persists longer. So we think that's how it functions. So at the base level, that's kind of how I want to tie the case study to that lecture. So I want to move on from the case study unless there are any questions. So you start to see why physiology is important as a prereq to want to be a nurse or a doctor. You don't know how the drugs work. You can't just pass them out. It's good if you know how they work and talk about it with the patient and stuff like that. All right. Well, let's start to kind of apply our knowledge to this picture there. Now, this is a model we have in the room. It's over there on the shelf. There's a little inset there. And I'm pointing to what I blew up and kind of turned on the side there. This is axon terminals, right? Okay, so that's our sarcomere or our triad. And there are things that you should be able to identify. What are the yellow balls filled with, these little vesicles? ACH. They were green on the figure for the quiz. You got two membranes here. You have a pre and postsynaptic. Okay. So what's like the orange one? Is that pre or postsynaptic membrane? It's going to be, think about it, pre. And then the white, if you follow the white, it's all ruffled. And it's post, belongs to the muscle fiber. And so the synapse is a very short distance between those two. You have mitochondria there. I want to move on. Another picture here. The neuromuscular junction. Now, I don't have a label for this one. Well, let's start with three. Three is pointing to a membrane. Pre or post? Post. Therefore, four is the space between the two membranes, pre and post, just synaptic cleft. Therefore, five is presynaptic membrane, okay? And I should have put a number there, but that little ball, these vesicles filled with ACH, they even show them fusing to the membrane there so they can be released in quantal bursts. So that's the synapse up there. More pictures of the model. Now that blue tube system shown here, if I had you identify that, what would you say? It's the whole T-tubule thing. It's how the action potential spreads deep in the muscle. There's other reasons for it. It's like if you need to mobilize glycogen stores, which are in the muscle, they can use the T-tubule system, okay? So you can see all these little holes are how these little transverse tubules can get deep inside and identify that, this beige stuff. You should say sarcoplasmic reticulum. If I specifically point to the end next to the blue tube, I'm going for the end sac or terminal cisterna. I think the models do a good job of showing you the structure. Hopefully the model. This is a satellite cell shown in the model. Their function is to kind of sop up and recycle ACH. So I think that's why they put it with this model. I didn't emphasize them too much. but I throw it in there because it's on the model, so I just want to at least give mention to its function. Satellite cells can kind of help sop up, recycle ACH from synapse. So I showed you this slide before. I kind of want to use it as a transition to remind us that we also have to learn about smooth muscle. The thing about skeletal muscle that we've been learning is there's this T-tubule, very well-developed system called the triad. You have this mechanism to release lots of calcium. And we also talked about how you can get this cross-bridge formation. Okay, and you have similar elements in smooth muscle, but I do want you to know the differences. So we start that knowledge of smooth muscle. They give you an example of smooth muscle, the one that lines the digestive tract, the GI tract. So notice that the muscle fiber structure is not there. Again, you have these spindle-shaped cells, right? I did this before, solitary nuke. It has contractile proteins in there, but there are no striations. You just can't see it. So this is what they look like longitudinally. So if you cut it this way, that's what they look like. You can see there's a double layer in this example. Okay, that helps the peristalsis process to have two layers oriented perpendicular to each other. It helps move food along in one direction. But to look at a single cell, you have to kind of shrink it down a little bit. So instead of the motor end plate thing, the axon terminal motor end plate, you have these little autonomic fibers, these varicosities. Okay. So let's remember our words. When I classified muscle, skeletal muscle, it's not autonomic. It's controlled by the somatic nervous system. But smooth muscle is autonomic nervous system. Okay, we haven't taught nervous system yet, so I just want to, the word autonomic should mean something to you here. So, you know, it's just a different category of nervous system in the human body. And so instead of a motor neuron, we have these autonomic nerve fibers that have these varicosities that release neurotransmitter, okay? Not the axon terminal with the neurotransmitter. Okay, so structurally, these cells are different. What they have that muscle fibers don't have are these little dense bodies, don't those? Because they connect these intermediate filaments. That's what the picture shows. Let me write that up. So you have, dense bodies. Intermediate filaments. So they kind of wrap around the cell so that when it actually does contract, you get this kind of spiral shape. Because the intermediate filaments with the dense bodies, it kind of like makes it twist and spiral when it contracts. Relaxed, contracted. when smooth muscle cell, sometimes I abbreviate SMC, when the smooth muscle cell contracts, it spiral twists. Here's another picture of it that I thought was a little better. This is bladder, which is smooth muscle. Do you see how like there's some cells, I pointed this general area here, they look kind of wavy? That's cells that have kind of done that twisting thing. Kind of reminds you of like, I don't know, the stripes in a barber pole. You know, that kind of spiral. That's kind of what you're getting there. The contraction, it kind of distorts the nuke, so it looks kind of all twisty. But anyways, that's the appearance of smooth muscle when it contracts. It doesn't shorten, it kind of corkscrews. Now the way you stimulate smooth muscle can either be all together or graded. So all together is unitary smooth muscle recruitment. Let's contrast those two terms. So recruitment can be unitary. Oh, sorry, can. So, okay, let's read what the structural thing is here. This muscle, smooth muscle that is recruited unitary style, has gap junctions for unitary contraction. The whole muscle is going to contract because gap junctions allow efficient spread of the signal. Okay, so the whole thing is going to contract. SMCs happen. Junctions, whole thing contracts. Now if you want a graded response, don't recruit them all, just recruit this. Oh, I need more, recruit more. Oh, I need a stronger response, recruit more. It's graded. Weak, medium, strong. This is just the whole thing or nothing because of the gap junctions. So multi-unit, there's no gap junctions. So it can't spread as easily. So what you gotta do is recruit for a graded response. Called multi-unit. We call them motor units, or these are trigger. So the idea is, I'm using this word recruit. That means in muscle physiology, use it. Okay, I want to recruit it because I'm using it. They choose that word, I'm not sure why. And also motor units. Maybe you haven't heard of that. It's like a motor unit in muscle physiology is the nerve and all the cells it can stimulate. The nerve plus all cells it can stimulate. That's a unit. They come together because muscle is an excitable tissue. You need the nerve ending and then all the fibers it does. Okay? So this one, it's like the nerve will get the whole muscle. And this one, you get a more nuanced response. Nerve gets motor unit number one. oh, that's not enough force. Let's have a stronger stimulus. Let's recruit another one to get a stronger response. So you have a graded response. Graded means it's not all or none, it's graded. Like for example, you get grades in this class, why do we call them grades? Some are A's, some are B's, some are C's, some are D's, all right? It's graded. And you want to be in the A group, but not all of you are going to get A's. It's the same thing. It's graded. There's levels. So it could be weak, could be strong in its response. Is this graded? Yes or no?
No.
Or it's just all or none. That's not really graded. It's just you either you recruit it or you don't. This one is, they use the term graded. All right, so here's a picture of what happens inside the muscle fiber. So let's kind of start at the top and kind of take a look at this. This is the, we call it excitation contraction coupling. This is a term that can be used with both skeletal or smooth, okay? I don't want you to think it's exclusive to smooth. I don't know if I expressly got it in your notes for skeletal. Excitation means, well, what is exciting muscle? Nerves. Okay. When the nerve stimulates the muscle contracts. We know that sarcomere is shortened. We know that smooth muscle twists in a corkscrew. They're coupled because if you stimulate one, you get the other. That's why you use the term coupling. All right. So here's here it is in smooth. So you get entry of calcium. Calcium enters the ECF via voltage. Dependent or voltage independent calcium channels or from SR. Okay, I don't know why you use scant SR, but the point is increase intracellular calcium levels. Okay, so that's what's happening. So again, the picture shows it either enters the cell, okay, it's from the extracellular, it gets the intracellular, or it's released from SR. That's what we saw also for skeletal muscle. Release from the SR. Now the next step is, that's like a second messenger. It binds and activates to a calmodulin. Calmodulin is a very common system in second messenger systems for all molecular biology, not just smooth muscle. So this we did not see a skeletal muscle, this calmodulin system. And what it does is it activates kinases. Or it says activated calmodulin activates the myosin light chain kinase enzyme. So kinases are basically enzymes that can do a lot of stuff in cells. So I'll just say calcium activated. Calmodulin increases, I'll say it activates kinases. Okay? Increase your kinase activity. Activates kinases. The activated kinase enzymes catalyze transfer of phosphate to myosin, activating the myosin ATPase. So basically, you're turning on the ATPases that work in the contractile proteins. That's what that does. So it's all about the kinases. So what they do, next step, kinases activate myosin ATPases. Okay, so that's what you see there. You're transferring a phosphate group to here to get to activate that ATPase. Because once you get to here, this myosin ATPase will make the muscle work. Step below here. Last step. So now, the myosin, what it says there, activated myosin forms cross bridges with actin of thin filaments, and then the shortening begins. Okay, see, thick and thin, 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 thick. And notice that the direction is kind of like this, both directions. Whereas before, we just saw it moving towards the M line. So that's why you get that kind of twisting. It's a little different arrangement here. So from here, you got your ATPases. Now your activated myosin molecules forms cross bridges and contraction occurs. That process is a little different. I wanted to take some time with that slide, and that completes that lecture. I want to move on to the next one immediately. It kind of transitions nicely into cross-bridge cycling. And the muscle twitch. So we're transitioning away from smooth muscle back to skeletal muscle. I want to punch out some details that I didn't mention before. Okay, now I think I'm through the neuromuscular junction part, where I talked about all the events here and how the AP spreads, and then I talked about this, right, where calcium is then released and you get cross bridge cycling. But I didn't really hash out all the details about the cross bridge formation and how it cycles. Okay, and that's essential for you to know for muscle function, for skeletal muscle. So again, write in your notes, this is for skeletal muscle. What we just took notes on was for smooth. So excitation-contraction coupling, that's it for skeletal, those three little pictures. It kind of summarizes the whole chapter. So cross-bridge cycling, taught in every physiology book, trying to get students to know the details of the bottom figure. And this figure doesn't show it all, okay? This figure shows a little more. They add an extra step. And essentially, you're looking at attached pull release, okay? It's a ratchet mechanism, and it cycles, and it's very rapid. So it keeps repeating until the contraction is done, all right? And so we want you to know the details of how it attaches and releases and uses ATP. okay, this figure starts, you can start anywhere when it's a cycle. It starts with the cross bridges is formed already, okay? Cross bridge cycle, step 104, cross bridge formation. All right. Things to take note of. If you haven't been studying, at least you can recognize, oh, that's the thick, that's the thin. Why is it a cross bridge? What's touching what? Well, we have to identify. This head is attached to this molecule here. That's the actin subunit. That's the cross bridge. Okay. Other thing to note, besides that, let me write that down. So the cross bridge, what's the bridge? Myosin heavy head. Attached to the active binding site. That's that actin subunit we talked about last time. I'll just write actin. Okay, the active site was on the actin subunit. That's the most important thing. That's the cross bridge. The thing to notice is, notice the angle of the head. I'm just drawing the myosin part. See how it's like, they use the word cocked. Basically, they call that a high energy configuration because it has, the way the angle is, it can pivot that way. So right, this is high energy configuration. Can't remember which angle they measure. I can't remember if it's that angle or that angle. Well, we don't have to know. But just know that it's a high energy configuration. It has the potential to do work, to pivot. Okay, that's why that term is used. Also know, look at the ATP. It's been hydrolyzed, but it has those molecules haven't been released yet. So it's like it's ready to like fire, but it's not. Remember, because ATP is usually like that. When you break off the last phosphate, usually it just goes. But this one, somehow, the ATPase, it hydrolyzes it, but it's like you're holding on to ADP plus PI. You haven't quite released the energy yet to do the work, but you're going to. The other thing to note is, are the active sites covered or uncovered in this picture? Uncovered. They're uncovered. Otherwise, you couldn't have the cross bridge formation. Right. Do you see the calcium bound to troponin? You should be able to see that. I'll just write it here. You see the red balls bound to the yellow thing. You see that too. That's why it's uncovered. What uncovered it? Well, we'll get to it, but it's uncovered because calcium bound the troponin, which then changed the conformation, so it swept tropomyosin off the active site so you could have the cross bridge formation. So that's how we got here. Any questions on that? I'm gonna move on. It's cross bridge formation. It's called step 2 power stroke. Power stroke is a word I use. I don't know if that word is still used by your book. They call it power working stroke. This is the mechanical work of muscle, okay? I mean, what's happening? The myosin head is pivoting. See how it's pivoted? Look at this picture and then look at that picture. It moved.
So the mechanical work of muscle.
Yeah. Mechanical. I mean, what's a me- when people in physiology use the word mechanical, something physical is moving, right? As opposed to electrical, like ions moving. The cell twists, this molecule pivots. And so myosin head pivots, and notice it's releasing ADP and PI. I guess that's the energy release. So you finally release the energy between this bond, and you transfer it to this head so it can pivot. And they even put a little arrow here. It's like you pivot the head and that whole hinge region moves. Look at the arrows. You know, you're sliding, the actin is sliding past the myosin in that direction. And it's happening from the other side too, right? This is only showing you half the picture. Actin slides past stationary myosin. And we call that the sliding filament theory, so I want to move on. This is the most important step. I know everything comes off sounding the same. This is the most important step because this is muscle contracting, the power stroke. So you're utilizing the ATP to do this. So you can see that you need ATP. In a muscle cell, muscle cells can burn through all of their ATP with maximal force in about 8 to 10 seconds. In 8 to 10 seconds, all the ATP is gone, right? Just the ATP that's there. So what's that long enough to do? You know, maybe a 100-meter sprint. And all the ATP is gone. So then where do you get the ATP after that? You don't just collapse. Well, there's other energy systems, right? There, you could use glycogen, right? So use ATP up. It's there. You start the race. Gone in 8 to 10 seconds. Gone. So you need to generate more. So you have to use your energy reserves, like glycogen. Are the glycogen metabolistic chemical pathways, are those aerobic or anaerobic? Anaerobic. You exhaust those in about 1.5 minutes. Okay. So what's that long enough to do? Maybe in the Olympics, 2 laps around the track, right? Well, what do you use after that? Not anaerobic, but aerobic. After that, it is all the aerobic stuff. You can run a marathon, right? So just keep going. But anyways, just the ATP that's there in well-trained athletes, you burn it in about 10 seconds. You have to make sure. It would help if you carb-loaded before, right? So you can have some glycogen. Anyways, let's get back to this figure here. Okay, good, so you did the work. Now you have to detach, and so you can retach. That's what's shown here. We call this cross-bridge detachment. So the myosin detaches from the actin. That's what's being illustrated there. Notice ATP is required. This doesn't happen without ATP. See that? ATP required. for this detachment. ATP, you need it for a second reason. One reason, you need it for this. That's one reason to need ATP, okay? The detachment. The other reason why you need ATP to kind of is to pump the calcium back into SR. ATP required to pump calcium ions back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Because as long as calcium is there, the muscle is going to continue to contract. But what if you want to finish? What if you're done with your muscle contraction? So, I mean, that's if the second one is if the muscle wants to relax. But if you don't want to relax, you want to keep going. You want to repeat. Okay. But you do need ATP for that. You know, that's why it's like, you hear of like, you know, that term rigor mortis. That's when the body gets stiff due to rigor. So when a person dies and the doctor pronounces death, that's just organ system failure. Now, cell death doesn't happen at that moment. It may happen 6 to 8 hours later, you know. Because the cells are still alive and still metabolizing. But when what rigor mortis is, the dead cell after 6 to 8 hours after death, that finally runs out. So if there's no ATP to release that, the body becomes stiffer. We call that rigor mortis. Okay. Now you can kind of break those yourself, but I want you to know that's why. A dead cell doesn't produce ATP. The cross bridges don't detach. Well, let's say you want to reattach and repeat the cycle. What you got to do is next step. Let me, before I transition to this step, do you see this step? Do you see the position of the head? Like that. They call this a low energy configuration. It can't do any work. The head's already pivoted. Just call it low energy configuration. This head can't do work, so you have to re-energize it so it can get to that high energy position again. So that's this step here. So you go from that to this. Okay, it's like you re-cock the head. It's kind of like a starter's pistol, on a revolver. Like after you fire the gun, it's like this. If you want to re-fire the gun, you have to like pull the hammer back, right? That's like going from this to that picture. So they call it cocking of Myelson head. You hydrolyze the ATP, but again, you don't release it yet. So you're back to your ADP PI, that helps to re-cock it, okay? So I'm gonna write, hold on to. ADP plus PI. Organic phosphate. And the myosin head is cocked into a high energy position. I'll just say myosin and in a high energy configuration. Here's another picture of the cross bridge formation. But a different view. Instead of a longitudinal view, it's kind of like a cross-sectional view. And I thought it'd be good to give you two figures of the same thing with a different viewpoint to make sure you kind of know what you're looking at. So in this way, in this figure, they put the thin filament in the middle. Do you see that? The double string of pearls. And on either end, they put a thick myosin right here. So in the first frame, what you're supposed to see, do you have cross bridge formation here? Yes or no? You do not. Some of you are seeing that. Do you see the active site? It's colored yellow right there. And I like how they show the troponin and the tropomyosin right on top of the active site. Now, when calcium comes, it sweeps it aside. I like how they illustrate that. Now, as soon as it's swept aside, there must be some kind of attraction there. The cross bridge will form in the last frame. Okay. So it's a different way of looking at the same thing. I thought it was good for you to see that. And I want to move on. I want to take a step back from cross bridge cycling if there are no questions. It's labeled there, same picture. And I want to talk about whole muscle contraction. So start to get it ready for the PhysioX lab. Again, now we're back to skeletal muscle, done with smooth muscle. Not even going to talk about cardiac muscle because you'll get that next semester. And you see a prep. Obviously, this muscle is a living tissue. It still works. You remove it from a small animal, and you can kind of run experiments. But before I do that, I should probably define different kinds of contraction that kind of come up in these labs. The effects of athletic training. Well, let me define the different kinds of muscle contraction that are being illustrated on that picture here. And I want to emphasize, now we're talking about a whole muscle contracting, because I've been talking about the sarcomere, cross-bridge cycling, the fiber, these microscopic things. Now we're taking a step back and like doing experiments where we remove a whole muscle and just watch it contract, right? So there are some terms that are used in these kinds of lectures, like muscle tension. Tension is a pulling force. This is the force exerted by the muscle, basically. Okay. Now, most students haven't taken physics. Force means something. It's mathematically calculated, but I guess you don't have to know that. Just know that tension is a pulling force. You should know that. Load. The load is the weight being moved by the muscle. Or not moved if it's too heavy. It's a possibility. Other terms, different kinds of contraction. There's isotonic, isometric contraction. Start with isometric. Now the word isometric means same length. Iso means same. So, in this type of contraction, the muscle is in a state of contraction, but it's not shortening. The muscle length stays the same. So muscle contracts, but muscle length stays the same. example could be, you know, my hinge joint example. It's like, say for example, you're trying to pull up a metal cord on a metal ring tied to the floor, and you're not going to lift that. So this muscle length, whatever it is, sometimes they use the term this L sub naught to mean initial length or resting length, some length, okay, where the muscle's in a state of contraction, could be initial length or resting length. Whatever that length is, it's not changing. The muscle's contracting, but you know, it's not shortening because you can't lift that. That's a good example of an isometric contraction. Okay, or if you hold some like pose, you're lying on the ground and your chest is off the ground, you're holding it for a minute. The muscle length is definitely contracting, it burns, but it's staying at the same length. Okay, so concentric and eccentric contractions are examples of isotonic contraction. So isotonic means the same tension. The tone, tension, same tone. Okay. The muscle tension generated to lift the load is constant. It doesn't change. So for example, I'll use my hinge joint again. If I have a 10-pound weight bearer and I want to flex, there's my initial length. But if I flex and I move the joint, now, clearly the muscle is shortened. That's called concentric, isotonic, concentric. Muscle contracts, overcomes the load, shortens. Okay, so I should probably label that. So you have isotonic, concentric. What I said is muscle contracts, you can move the load, you can overcome it. Muscle shortens. Go from there to there, that's basically what you're saying. Let's say, for example, you just want to play a trick on this guy. You're gonna change that to like 50 pounds. No, too heavy, so let's put it down. Okay, so you want to like put it out, put it down in a nice controlled movement. So go from this length, whatever it is, L, to this length. In a nice controlled movement, just to kind of put that thing down. This is the example of isotonic eccentric.
Is the term isotonic applicable to eccentric and eccentric?
Yes. Yes, I'll explain why in a second here. That's a good point. Okay, so eccentric is same thing. The muscle's in a state of contraction. But it's not really shortening because the load is too heavy. Load too heavy. Load is too heavy, therefore, yes, the muscle lengthens. So we use the word contraction, but it's lengthening. Okay, if you put it down in a nice controlled movement. So you can be in a state of contraction and actually shorten, or be in a state of contraction and lengthen. Now the reason the term isotonic is used is because it means tone. What is the tension needed to move a 10-pound weight through this range of motion from here to here? 10 pounds. Well, technically, 10.000001. It has to be a greater force, right? I know someone's going to ask me that. So let's just say 10 pounds. Now, through the range of motion, does that change from here to here? Does the load change, yes or no?
No.
No. It's just a 10-pound weight, okay? So that's why the tone to move 10 pounds is 10 pounds. Does that tension ever have to change when you're moving that load? No, because this is always 10 pounds. Same tone. Right, now what about this one? As you put this down from there to there, does that change? Does that load change? Well, no. That resistance stays the same. Now, it's too heavy. I guess you don't have to do this, right? You could just drop it on your foot. Just let gravity do the work. But you want to put it down nice and controlled. You know, weightlifters call this the negative, right? That's the positive. So on the way down, that's the negative. That's very important. The weight down is very important. Actually, you ever experience sore muscles when you start a workout? Or maybe you increase your workout and you get sore. It's called delayed onset muscle soreness. Usually happens 1 to 2 days after starting a new workout or increasing your workout. Okay, you get sore. And we think it's due to a breakdown of the connective tissues I've been talking about, but usually it's due to the eccentric, okay, that soreness you feel. So it is important, and I just want you to know the definition. Do you know why it's isotonic? Is it concentric, eccentric? Any questions on that? We'll move on. So I have some notes here. Muscles that function under no load, even if they're exercised for hours, they increase little in strength. Okay, so maybe that's more for cardio, not necessarily putting on muscle mass. Muscles that contract at more than 50% max force will develop strength rapidly. Okay, so what's your max? Well, you gotta figure out what your max is depending on what the movement is. Say it's bench press. Maybe your max is 225 or 300. Whatever you could do one or two times, depending on who you talk to, that's your max. So 50% of that max, research shows, you put on muscle. Muscle building can happen, you know, if you do 6 near max reps performed in 3 sets per day, 3 days per week. Okay, so that's near max, 3 sets a day, 3 per week. That's why athletes like to abuse those anabolic androgenic steroids. If you're on the steroids, it gives you this freakish strength. You could lift your max every day. okay? Put on this, big as a house, right? I think we all familiar with some stories with that, but anyways, normally, you should only be able to lift your max every other day, okay? This will give an optimal increase in muscle strength without producing chronic muscle fatigue. With training, muscles can hypertrophy 30% to 60% due to increased fiber size. Okay, so get that. You're not increasing the number of fibers. You're increasing the fiber size. Probably more myofibrils. So that's the effect of training. Okay, so I define these. The phase of contraction, that's what I defined here. Isometric, isotonic, concentric, eccentric. There's other ones I won't get into as much. There's reflexive contractions. You know, like a knee jerk. You tap the tendon and you kick a little bit. That's voluntary muscle, but that's an involuntary response. So that's an example of voluntary muscle being involuntary, a reflex, knee jerk. There's tonic contraction, which is muscle tone. Even when the muscle is relaxed and you're living, breathing, basically I say you got a pulse. You got a pulse, you're sitting down. There's tone in your quadriceps right now, even though you're not using them. There's always signals going back and forth between your nervous system and your muscle tissue to give you tone. Okay? You're not dead weight, you're living weight. You have tone in your muscles even when you're not using them. All right, so let's get into the muscle twitch. So, you know, imagine you're in a laboratory setting, it's the 1950s, and you're trying to figure out how muscle works. Okay, so this is kind of what we're talking about here. A good place to start is to see muscle's response to a single stimulus. And that's why we study the muscle twitch. That's kind of what you're talking about there. It's kind of a laboratory phenomenon. So we're going to study this picture, but like this is like the prep setup, which you're going to do for Physio X. I just kind of screenshot the Physio X and put it in here to warm you up for that lab. I'll go online and show you the PhysioX where it is so you can find it. That way I won't get a lot of emails. Oh, I can't find it. It's kind of difficult to find. You got to click around. And you think you found it, but then you have to click one more time. So I'll be sure you guys know where to go to get to here. All right, so we're studying in the lab. We're in the lab, right? It's a simulation, so you're not in the lab. So I'm going to put in the lab in quotes, okay? But what you have to do to get to this point is, you're not going to do it, but you have to remove a muscle from, like I said, a small animal. Like, when I was a grad student, I had to prepare undergrads for this lab, I had to sacrifice frogs. I didn't feel good about it. I'll have to go take 6 frogs, put them in a box, hopping around. I have to take them to the guillotine. I have to decapitate and pith. That's what you do. It's a normal, standard procedure. Okay. I didn't like it. And it's kind of funny. I felt so guilty. I would take like 8. Kill 6, put 2 back, so I felt like I was letting them free or something. I don't know. I really had an issue with it. And I'm glad now we have simulations. We don't have to do that anymore. I don't think we should. You guys will get the concepts from the simulation. But this is what physiologists would do back in the day to figure out how muscle works. They had to do it. They didn't know. Okay. So the muscle we used was gastroc. And the undergrads would do this. You could do it. You would do it well. Let me just set this thing up, and okay, so what you got there, it's like, this muscle's all strung up, there's some tension on here, you got your electrodes in there. Sometimes you can just dissect the nerve with it, and stimulate the nerve to stimulate the muscle, or you can just shove your electrodes right in there. Yeah. So you got this prep here where it's like, trying to draw that basically, and it is not here. So this thing's all strung up. There's my muscle. Maybe there's a force transducer here. This flexible metal wire. Force transducer. This box I drew on the bottom. And I drew it kind of hooked up to this tendon down there. Now the reason why you need a force transducer, you need something to convert the signal to something you can measure. Okay, so this will transduce the force, it's calibrated. And back in the day, they didn't have computers, so what they would do is, they would just put like a pen, literally an ink pen, a marker, you know. And they would have chart paper, okay? And it's like, you're like, chart paper, a pen, what? That's what they did. You hit the go button, the chart paper runs at a certain speed, okay? And then you got your electrodes in there, it's hooked up to an amp. Yeah. Amplifier. Well, basically, it applies voltage. I don't know how much, 8 volts, something. You can see it on there, right? Zap it, give it some juice. Complete the circuit. What's completing the circuit? The muscle, okay? We're stimulating it. Okay, well, anyways, this is volts. And you give it one zap, one response, okay? The muscle twitch is the muscle response from a single stimulus. Let me write that down. Muscles response from a single stimulus. You know, in the organism, it will be a single action potential. But for us, it's a single zap from our amp. I'll put action potential in parentheses. Okay, so you hit the chart paper, and let's say, you know, the chart paper is running, and it's like flatline, right? Because you haven't hit the zap button yet. But as soon as you hit the zap button, the muscle's gonna contract in this way, right? Like that. It's gonna twitch. And when it twitches, can you see how the ink pen would twitch with it? It would like flip like that, okay? Like real quick. That's what it looks like. So it goes flat line, and then like when the pen twitches, it's like makes a waveform like that.
This is an EMG test, basically?
It's not EMG.
No?
EMG is
so
just
similar to it.
EMG is measuring the electrical activity for a whole muscle during a whole state of contraction. It's just summing up the electrical signal. We're actually going to do that, so I'm glad you're curious. This is just looking at a muscle's response from a single stimulus. It twitches, and this is what a twitch looks like, okay? Any questions on that setup? Because I want you to know what you're looking at when you look at this. I just want you to know how they got this data, because you have to know what it all means. Well, let me at least define these different parts of the twitch curve, and we'll take a break. Question was asked about EMG. EMG, what you do is you put the electrodes on the skin surface, and then the muscle contracting underneath it, and the computer can pick up the signal. Okay, so we're not going to cut you open and take your muscles out, right? We don't do that. We do it to frogs. That's a fun lab. Okay, well, anyways, we'll get to that. So the twitch response, what do we see here? Okay, we see this latent period, the darkest blue on the left, which spots curve. Now, before we actually get into dividing the parts, do you see what's on the x-axis and the y-axis? Look at the y-axis first. That's the force. Percent of maximum, okay, I don't like how they label it. It's just the tension generated. Maybe it's 3 grams of force. Usually, grams of force, this will twitch wrong. Sorry. Now, the twitch response, usually force of grams or kilograms, that's the force measured over time. Usually milliseconds. So the force is usually on y-axis, over time, x-axis. Okay, so that's what you're looking at there in terms of a graph. So that first bit of time is a latent period, nothing happens. You'll have to measure it in your twitch experiment. It could be a few milliseconds, maybe 2, maybe 1. Nothing's happening. There's no force being generated. Basically, this is the time from stimulus to the time when you first generate enough tension to register. Time from stimulus. At that time, as soon as you hit the zap button, the tension is zero to the time you first see some force. Let me phrase that better. Time from stimulus from the time you first see force register on your graph. Let me phrase it very clearly because you're actually going to do this. You're going to start at zero and then let you move the cursor out until you see force, whatever that time is. So let's say 0 grams, nothing's happening yet. I mean, it takes some time before you get the twitch. I don't know. Maybe at 0.0 milliseconds, you got 0 grams. Okay, maybe you go out to something like 2.3 milliseconds and you see 0.01 grams, I don't know, something like that. Oh, I see something. Okay, oh, therefore, latent period over. So that's close to your latent period. So that's what it is, nothing's happening. Just the time from stimulus to where you start to see something. Not very long. Now, after that, pretty much the muscle's in a state of contraction. So the period of contraction that's pretty much after this time, all the way to peak tension. Max tension achieved, right here. So you can see the top of the curve. They kind of put the end of that zone, period of contraction, the end of this period, at the peak tension. By definition, that's when it's done. So imagine what's happening at the cell level here. You're getting your max cross-bridge cycling, right? It keeps ratcheting and ratcheting until you get your peak tension for this single stimulus. Max cross cross-bridge cycling. Then there's a longer time where the tension falls off. And they give you the time there. You can note the time if you want. So the period of contraction is like after these few to like all the way to about 30. Then the longest time is the period of relaxation there.
Excuse me.
Muscle relaxes. So what you see about the shape of the waveform is it's not instantaneous. It takes a bit of time. Okay, it doesn't just go straight down to zero from the peak. There's a kind of a nice downhill. So during this time, it's like the cell is pumping calcium back into the SR, right? So it can relax. Alright, so that's a single twitch. When we come back from break, I want to tell you how we can kind of manipulate that, see how muscle really works. So come back in about 15 minutes after break.